Good evening, everyone. Well, I'd like to welcome you to the November 13th meeting, the special meeting of the City Council. We also have a study session this evening. We just, for your information, the reason we're a bit late is we had the legislative teams from both the 41st and 45th here this evening, legislative districts. And we had a very good conversation with them on things that affect the city and affect you. And it was, I think, a very good session. It's the first time we've had both of our new districts here at the same time, and it's worked very well, I thought. So I'm going to ask the city clerk to call the roll.
Mayor Tom O'Dell.
I'm here.
Deputy Mayor John Day.
Here.
Councilmember John Curley. Councilmember Don Jaren.
Here.
Councilmember Romero Valderrama.
Present.
Councilmember Tom Vance.
Here.
Councilmember Nancy Whitten.
Present.
Councilmember Curley will not be able to attend for personal reasons tonight.
Okay.
You've notified us.
I move that we excuse Councilmember Curley for personal reasons.
I'll second. It's been moved and seconded to excuse Councilmember Curley. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. By our vote of 6-0, Councilmember Curley is excused. Okay, I'm going to ask Deputy Mayor James to lead us in the pledge this evening.
Oh, a twofer.
Yeah.
Of course, I just put something in my mouth, excuse me.
I saw you.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. May I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Mayor, with the exception of, was that the lead on the consent agenda?
Well, we can wait on the consent agenda and do that separately. I know where you're going. Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Vote of 6-0, the agenda is approved. We do not have any presentations or proclamations this evening, so we'll move on to public comment. This is an opportunity for the public to address the council. There is a 3-minute limit per person, or 5 minutes if you're representing the official position of a recommended community organization. We do ask that when you come up to the podium, if you plan to speak, that you give your full name and address for the record. When we get through with the people that have signed up, I will call twice for additional parties who wish to address the council, and then we'll move on with the rest of the agenda. Thank you. So we have a number of people who have signed up this evening. I'll call them in the order in which they signed up. The first one is Stephanie Hibner. And again, please give your name and address.
Certainly. Hi, my name is Stephanie Hibner, and I live at 23610 Northeast 6th Street. I'm one of the co-chairs of the Community Garden Steering Committee, and I'm here tonight on behalf of the committee to voice our support for the staff recommended location of moving the garden to the Lower Commons. I also wanted to thank the council and the Parks Department for the work that's been done to date on the garden. We know nothing has been decided yet, but I want to assure you that we look forward to working with you and developing the garden and to creating a place that's a real asset for our community. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person who has signed up is Mark McGill.
Evening, everyone. My name is Mark C. McGill. I'm at 21553 Southeast 28th Lane. And I want to address my comments tonight to the legislative meeting. And basically, under Attachment A, I think it is the legislative priorities, under other, there is a mention of public records requests, which are considered harassing or bullying. So I'm not really sure. The information is a little thin, so we're just trying to find out what constitutes the, you know, harassing, excuse me, request. And will there be some adoption of some language or something that'll define that? In other words, if there's consecutive requests for emails or things like that over and over again, will those be considered harassing? And also, I think City of Sammamish can afford any kind of request if this is a financial thing. I know some of the cities and municipalities that are connected with this are doing this because of the costs. But I think the City of Sammamish can afford to do any public requests that, records requests that are requested. So thank you very much.
Well, let me kind of take this on, and other council members can interject if they'd like. This was a general discussion topic this evening. It was not meant to get into any kind of detail. And the reason it's on here is, while it hasn't affected us thus far from a very serious standpoint, there are a number of cities in the state that have been, frankly, driven to financial ruin because of repeated, numerous, and very expensive requests from individuals or parties of individuals who have an axe to grind. And I suppose you could say you really don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater here, but it was a very general discussion about the problem as a whole, not about the City of Sammamish. In fact, we made the point during our meeting that the number and volume of the requests that we've had have not been thus far terribly onerous. Yes, we do get Freedom of Information Act requests all the time, but there are a number of examples around the state where it has just driven communities to the point of having to disincorporate. There's one city where it took 30% of their general budget to deal with this. And these were all generated by a single individual who had some sort of axe to grind. We didn't come to any conclusions tonight. We didn't set any bounds. It was basically an exchange of ideas. So yeah, I hope you. That helps, Bert.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to now ask Jim Chambers to come up.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm Jim Chambers. I live at 21700 Southeast 16th Place, and I'm here to discuss the Southeast 8th Park on behalf of myself and my neighbors on Southeast 16th. We've had a chance at this point to see some of the proposed plans, the revised plans that the Parks Department's going to be presenting tonight. And generally, on behalf of the neighbors, we're pretty pleased where this has gone. It's been a great community effort. It's moved quite a ways from formal gardens to a naturalistic preserve. We're very excited about this and looking forward to seeing how it works out in the master plan with the actual detail as far as what is spelled out in that document for the park. We look forward to, in some fashion or another, being part of that process and see what we can do to offer some help with it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chambers. Appreciate your comments. Janet Wilson.
Hi, I'm Janet Wilson at 1653 219th Place Southeast, Sammamish, Washington. And just like Jim said, by the way, who is one of my neighbors, I'd like to thank the Parks Department and Jesse et al. For all the meetings, the community input, and so on, was put together. Not only was it productive, but it was fun. I mean, we got to know each other even better. So with that, also, I'd like to maintain the spirit of those community meetings, say that we really appreciated the outcome in terms of keeping the park as a natural area, if not a full-out preserve. We're delighted with that. And in that spirit, I'd like to just make sure that any sort of picnic shelters really be maintained as picnic tables, because again, we don't want big edifices, big structures there. And also take another look. Currently, there are 10 parking spots there, which in addition to the other ones on the 8th Street would be, there's 44, 10, count my math, 55 plus maybe 3 at Lancaster. So we would ask that from those community meetings that those number of 10 be reduced back to about 4, which is what we came out of those meetings with, 4 to 6. And then also in terms of the Freed House, we would ask that that not have activities, but be really a viewing kind of artifact, if you will, where people can peek in the windows. And again, that was very much the sentiment of some of those community meetings. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Greg Perimba.
Greg Perimba, 21915 Southeast 16th Place. Also wanted to make a couple comments about the Southeast 8th Park. A lot of hard work went into generating the figure that represents the developments that are going to go in the park, and everybody's like to be complimented for their efforts on that. However, in my mind, in park plans I'm used to working on, that's only a small piece of what's actually in a park plan. You actually have a lot of narrative that goes with that to support it, including things like the purpose of the park, the goals of the park, existing facilities and uses, future changes in those, you know, all the details about what that picture shows, policies for contingency if things happen, things like describing the picnic shelter rather than just having a little square on a map, things like that. So unfortunately, I didn't have a chance to ask Jesse or the city when we might, you know, when that's going to be developed and when we might get a chance to look at that. But I would really appreciate a chance to look at that. And, you know, because the devil's in the details, as they always say. I also would appreciate a chance to look at the SEPA checklist that would go with this, just to see what that has to say about potential impacts. And that's it. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That brings us to the end of the sign-up list. Are there other people in the audience who wish to address the council this evening? This is your opportunity. Okay, one more time. Is there anyone who wishes to address the council? Not seeing anyone, I'm going to close public comment. So we will now move on to the consent agenda. And Romero, well, let me ask for an approval of the consent agenda.
Why don't you defer to Romero, maybe add his amendment?
Okay.
You want to start, Romero, with the motion and then the make motion.
That's correct. I motion that we, or the request that we take off the item one, approval, purchase, and sale agreement of King County from the consent agenda for discussion.
Okay. Is there a second to that?
I don't think you need seconds.
Okay. That's right.
I would move that we approve the consent agenda as amended.
Okay. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as amended. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say nay. By our vote of 6-0, the consent agenda as amended is approved. So let's go right into the...
Don't you need a motion to approve the agenda, or have we done that?
We've done that.
As amended? Okay.
We've done that.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, you want to take the Council Member Valderrama's issue so we can get...
That's where I was going to go, Mr. Yeah. Senator. Let's take that up right now.
Yeah, maybe you can ask. If you have questions, we can answer that. I mean, this is a... Maybe I'll give you a little background. This was in our budgeted objectives. This is a piece of property along Sahali Way. That is the only viable access that we could potentially provide to Evans Creek Preserve. That city just recently used 8,000 hours of the volunteers time to build the trails there. Parcel is currently owned by King County. We've been negotiating with the King County to transfer not only the parcels that potentially could be used for access point to Evans Creek, but we do also have a major drainage infrastructure right adjacent to it. And frankly, that drainage structure needs to be properly maintained. It is in our city. We have to maintain it.
It is affecting one of our major corridor, transportation corridors in and out of city. I might also further add that this was the council's specific objective for the city managers in the performance review to get this thing done. So, with that background, maybe that I can answer some questions.
Deputy Mayor James.
I think maybe it'd be appropriate if I made a motion to authorize the city manager to purchase the properties, and then we can go into discussion.
Thank you, Mr. McGill.
I would second.
Okay. So I'm seconded to authorize the city manager to proceed with the purchase of these four parcels. All in favor, say aye.
Wait.
Oh, wait, no, we had discussion.
Okay.
Good try.
I'm just trying to hurry up this meeting, guys. Okay, discussion on the issue.
I think Romero had his hand up.
I think Romero did have his hand up, so
absolutely.
Romero, that's yours.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, City Manager, for that background. And again, I think that it is a desirable piece of land. As I have previously stated and recognize the rationale, I am obviously concerned about paying for King County land that we've already paid for taxes. You've already discussed that we're getting it from a cash-poor unit of King County, and we're going forward. I'm interested in understanding what are the life cycle costs of this parcel that we're going to. We've talked about in here that we get some credit for the trail, but we don't talk about what the cost is estimated for that trail. I'd also be interested to understand what the maintenance operation expenses will be for these two parcels that are being brought in. And well, you've mentioned that King County has not been properly maintaining that segment of the road, but on the other hand, they have the liability should that road fail. And I'd be interested to understand from our perspective, especially with the clauses put in here that buyer buys as is with all conditions, what is the probability of that road possibly failing in the next 20 years, and what is the liability cost to the city estimated at? On the other parts of Sahali, we've set aside $1 million as a down payment should something happen. Should we be setting aside money for this parcel as well? So I'd just like to understand the life cycle costs here.
Let me answer those questions. Those are good questions. There's action before the council tonight is the land transfer, is not to build the trail, not to build the access. And that, given that, I cannot give you a specific estimate for the life cycle maintenance cost of the trail or the stairways that is going to be built, because I don't have a design in front of me to say it's a 500 feet long or 1,000 feet long and how many hours that we're going to spend on maintaining. So that will be coming. When we get to the point that we design the project, we will have a better idea. In terms of the drainage facility under Sahalway, we have been actually monitoring that with the geotechnical reports. We feel confident that it's not like something imminent as dangerous or critical as the Snake Hill Road project. So I'm not anticipating council to put money in there at this juncture. The drainage facilities, there is a deferred maintenance there. And as you look at the agenda bill, we are getting a proper credit for that deferred maintenance, almost about $100,000. To kind of recognize that, we need to do some maintenance activity. So on the purchase sales agreement, they're giving us about, let me just put my glasses on here, so $98,000, almost $100,000 credit for the deferred maintenance of the drainage facilities.
I understand that $100,000 is for the pedestrian access, not for the maintenance, is that correct?
I'm sorry?
The $100,000 credit is for pedestrian access, not for maintenance, as
there
I understand.
There are two.
That's the grant money that they already committed to giving to us for this overall land transfer. So if I walk through the numbers, the appraised value of the property is $322,000. We have $98,000 deferred maintenance. The cash due to county is about $224,000. Kind of recognize that importance of this piece and then future connection to the Evans Creek, so they're already committing to us $100,000 grant money. Net cost of the Sammamish is $124,000. I might also add that we may not even need to pay anything, which I didn't put this agenda bill because I haven't worked through the details with the county, and that is, do you remember that when we passed the transfer of development right ordinance, that county committed to giving to city $300,000. $350,000. once we identify a piece of parcel. This parcel will be a good candidate for that one, so we could take that $124,000 as a credit for it. Therefore, cost at the end of the day will be absolutely nothing for the city. I can't tell you when those payments are going to make, when, I mean, it may take some 6 months that we may have to make a payment, then we get reimbursement for some of the other things. It's a strategic piece of property. It is right adjacent to our Evans Creek Preserve. Drainage facility, I want us to maintain it. Sahali Road is our road. It is our main critical transportation corridor. I want to make sure that that stays in the best condition. I think one of the components of accomplishing that objective is maintaining the drainage properly. So with that, I strongly recommend council's authorization to finalize this agreement with the county. In terms of the process, council approves it tonight, then it goes to the King County Council. King County Council has to approve this also. But it is already supported by the county executive's office. And I've been dealing with this. My parks director has been part of it. Public works director has been dealing with it. It's been about a long process to get to this point.
Thank you, Mr. City Manager. I know that Councilmember Valderrama has some follow-up on that, but before we go back to him, are there other members of the council who wish to comment right off the bat? Councilmember Jared.
Mr. City Manager, could you clarify that we are not acquiring any more of Sahali Way, that we already own the road in front of those parcels?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. This is not a right-of-way transfer, open incorporation. The city takes the ownership of all public's right-of-ways. Parks, however, it's different. This particular piece of property is in the county's possession, is a park property. It's owned by the Parks Department. That's why we have to pay for this thing, and their road budget is in, it's very difficult circumstances, so they can't take the money from roads to pay for themselves internally, Parks Department.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor James.
This is not an unimproved piece of property. It already has a parking lot on it. And what did you value the, if we were to replicate that parking lot, how much would that cost the city?
I think that my staff is back there, so somebody refresh my memory. Just the storm drainage improvements to build the parking lot there would have been on the $150,000 to $200,000 range. And we have already paved parking place and the walking area and the railing, so it's about to close to $350,000 improvements. Is that an accurate number? I'm seeing they're shaking their heads.
So for a trailhead for a park, it's, nobody could have asked for a perfect, more perfect piece because it's already approved. All we have to do is put a trail down to it. We're getting $100,000 from the county to build that trail. There have been council members that have talked about building parks that are more accessible to people outside the city than to our own residents. Well, this is the poster child, Evans Creek Preserve. Anybody can get to this park as it stands today quicker than the Sammamish residents can. And if we acquire this piece, we will get an access point that is readily accessible to our own citizens. So how much money did we spend to do the improvements over and above the land purchase to Evans Creek Preserve? We just finished the project.
It's about $1 million. There's still some left over in the budget that we need to complete a few things, but it's about $1 million.
So we're taking a $1 million investment plus the $1.8 million we paid for the property, and we're spending $124 to insert the missing piece, $124,000 to insert the missing piece of the puzzle. So I am absolutely supportive of this. I wish it had been available the day that we opened the park, and I can't wait to have Tom O'Dell do the ribbon cutting there to open this section.
Thank you.
Last question going forward, again, reiterating, I am supportive of this parcel. What I am interested in is having the full understanding of the total cost and liabilities. With that, on a previous parcel that we were looking at acquiring that was rejected by this council, the city was able to provide an estimate of a trail coming down of $1 million, which was a major factor on us walking away from that deal. Do we have a guesstimate of what the trail would cost on this, since you were able to do that for the last?
Well, remember, the last time we looked at it, there was a major utility easement going through that piece.
Understand.
That would have made the things a lot more difficult and a lot more expensive. So that's why it was more expensive.
I just want a rough order of magnitude.
I don't have a number for you, Councilmember Valderrama. I mean, any number that I give you would be just based on grabbing the number up in the air, and I hate to do that. But I'm assuring you, we will get you the number when we get to the design completed.
If my recollection is correct, the route that was talked about by Councilmember Valderrama just a second ago was A, fairly long, and B, very challenging due to the nature of the terrain in that particular area.
Bunch of turns, very steep, narrow area.
Again, operating off memory, I believe this trail will be considerably shorter and also technically less difficult from an engineering point of view to construct.
Thank you, Mayor.
The other thing, too, is that, and I may be getting myself into trouble with Jesse, but I believe the discussion heretofore has been that we'd attempt to use as much volunteer labor as possible. And I'm getting an affirmative head nod from Jesse in the back to afford the construction of this trail. So I think it's a good idea. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Whitten.
Isn't this where there was an existing very out of repair gravel road that was used for logging that
yes.
we've walked down?
Yeah.
Which suggests to me at least that it would be quite feasible to develop something mm-hmm. Going forward. You know, so I see both sides of this mm-hmm. where normally you don't want to go into a piece of property that has no utility value to you, but I think here it clearly does, and there is an existing trail that's actually used by pedestrians now. So I think I like the idea that this is a much better parcel than the other one we looked at in terms of giving us access, even though it may be pretty much one way downhill.
Thank you.
This is the same roadway that Council Member Gerrard and the mayor managed to traverse down and get down in one piece.
Yeah, we only lost one staff person.
Even before it was improved, so this one is very doable. Are we ready for the question here?
We are.
Okay. Okay, we've got the motion. So I'm going to just simply call a question. All in favor of this motion, say aye.
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 Opposed, say nay. By our vote of 6-0, the motion is approved.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Now, back... on let's see, where are we? On the public hearing, item number 3 on our book is a second reading authorizing collection of service water system development charges, providing for severability and establishing an effective date. Mr. City Manager, do you have anything to say on this?
Mr. Mayor, we had already multiple study sessions, and then we also made an extensive presentation on the first reading of the ordinance. Frankly, at this point, that instead of, because you have a long agenda towards the end, that the two items, unless you have questions,
I think we held public hearing over, so I'm going to have to reopen public hearing, however briefly, and then we'll move on with it.
Yep.
So at this point, I'm going to reopen public hearing on this this measure. This is, again, the second reading of an ordinance to modify the city's surface water management system development charges. Is there any member of the public who wishes to address the council at this point? Second request, is there any member of the community that wishes to address the city council on this issue? Seeing none, I'm going to close public hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
And request that...
we need a council motion to mm-hmm. approve the ordinance.
May I have a motion, please?
So move.
Second.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded that we approve this ordinance for new system development charges. All in favor say... discussion? Pardon me. Council Member Jerry.
Just briefly, I want to point out that because of the new mandates that's come down from the federal and state level and the National Pollution Discharge Elimination System, staff has done the calculations and determined that it's going to cost us quite a bit more money to maintain those facilities to those standards, and that's the large reason, justification for this increase in charges.
That's well over $1 million.
Per year.
a year, I said. Any further discussion?
As a segue to that comment, so if you don't like the charges, I guess the segue would be call your state representative or senator and tell them you don't like it and see what they can do to help us out.
Mm-hmm. This, incidentally, was a subject of discussion in the legislators' meeting that occurred at this point a little over half an hour ago. So, we gave them our two bits on this, in the impact of this on our budget at that time. And I have to say they listened very carefully and I think are sympathetic. So, further comment? Question's been called. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed say nay. By our vote is 6-0, the motion passes. Thank you. Okay, our next issue is agenda item number 4, unfinished business. An ordinance for the third reading vacating easternmost 8 feet of 225th Avenue Southeast, south of Southeast 32nd Street, and adjacent to tax parcel number 09240692 01. Mr. City Manager.
Again, Mr. Mayor, we gave an extensive staff report on this. First, when we brought the request to you. Second, when we brought the ordinance first reading to you. And this is the second reading. What this one is a piece of right-of-way behind the sidewalk. City owns a 60-foot right-of-way throughout the city, portion of which on either side, we don't use it. And typically, private homeowners use that as part of the landscaping purposes and et cetera. In this case, we have a new development proposal, is actually willing to compensate the city for the use of those parcel. It's about the strip of the land behind the sidewalk. The appraised value of the land is about a $57,000, roughly about $60,000. The trade-off that the developer is offering to us that if we give him this particular strip of the land, it will allow him to build one extra lot. Thus, he would then in turn expand the existing storm drainage pond that would be a lot more expensive than the building a new one here. Maintenance cost of the storm drainage pond is about $3,500 per year. That's what my staff estimates. So when you do the 20-year life cycle analysis, that's about $70,000. So, in terms of the property tax, some of you asked the questions, and the impact fees, when you add all those numbers, due to 20-year analysis, this would be about $187,000, roughly, plus for the taxpayers, if you were to approve this particular vacation. If you don't, then we would have an extra storm drainage pond to maintain in this plat. That would be about a 20-year at cost of $70,000. Policy question for you is this road ever going to be widened? Answer to that question is no. This road dead ends at the Providence Point at the south end. That is in a different city. It's a gated community. Just like our gated community of Sahala Way, Sahala neighborhood, there are a lot of streets comes to that and it dead ends there. So this street is not going to go anywhere. Not in the city of Issaquah's plan, not in our city's plan. So with that, I recommend the council motion to approve this street vacation.
Thank you. Is there a motion for approval?
I think I made the motion last time. For consistency's sake, I'm willing to do the same. There was something in here that said reopen public hearing. Do we have to do that?
I don't think we do.
No.
Because we closed it last time.
Yeah, yes.
We did close it.
You know, I'll make a motion to approve the ordinance as written.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to approve the ordinance. Is there discussion, further discussion? Seeing as I'm the guy that brought this back up again, I'll say a couple of things. First of all, I had a bit of a problem with getting 50 cents on the dollar, really, for the property that would be vacated. If we had to go the other direction and condemn it, we would be paying fair market value for it. I know the law is the law as it sits, and frankly, this is going to be one of my issues with the state legislature in the future, that I think what's good for the goose is good for the gander here. I also had several questions on the business case, which I didn't feel were adequately addressed before, and I'd like to thank the city manager for chasing these down for me. While I'm still not completely happy here, I will vote for this.
Thank you.
So with that, we'll call the
Guerrero has
You can.
I'm sorry.
Ladies first.
I looked around before, no one wanted to say anything. So, okay, Councilmember Valderrama.
I've also been.
My apologies.
I'm also thankful for the city pulling together the information, the business case, and in particular, being able to talk with us and show us the investments the developer has to put into the modification and improvements of his stormwater drainage, which would be in excess of $250,000. So I will also be voting in support of this initiative and the savings it will incur to the city.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Councilmember Whitten?
I don't think the city should be vacating right-of-ways unless there's a good policy behind it. And here it's a dead-end street, so I think it's makes it in a distinct class, which you usually don't have. Secondly, it points out we need good standards. When it came up to us the first time, it became very clear that this was through a variance procedure that the city had been pretty uniformly, I understand, or consistently providing for this kind of a vacation in this kind of circumstance to in because of the desirability of narrower roads. Personally, I have a strong desire to see for the last X years, I mean literally 6 or 8 years, I've been hoping that the city would have an opportunity in its work plan to address the need to revise our road standards. I think it's really critical. I understand from talking to Mr. Miller that it's very expensive to go through a variance procedure. So I think it's much better policy on the city's behalf to have good standards that don't require variances.
I concur.
Say I'm going to be voting for this under these circumstances. I mean, especially with it's a dead end, it makes a lot of sense and the savings and other things. But in terms of where we go with this, I don't think we should be getting involved in a vacation process in most instances. I think, in fact, we need better standards so we don't see this situation coming back to us, taking staff time, developer time, and getting the same result we'd get if we had good standards.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Is there anyone else? Okay, not seeing it.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Mr. Mayor.
No, well, you wish to say something, Mr. C?
The standards is scheduled to be updated next year, but I have to tell you, the council, that even the standards is upgraded, the street vacation is a state law, it's a legislative matter that I have to bring it back before the council anytime it receives such requests. So I don't want you to be disappointed that in the future.
I understand that, but what I'm saying is if we had better standards for the width of the roads to begin with, one of the questions is narrower pavements on roads that aren't connector roads.
We'll take care of it.
And
next year is scheduled to be done.
If that were taken care of, a lot of these variances would go away.
Okay. Are we ready? All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Vote of 6-0, the motion is approved.
Thank you, Council.
Okay. This is the end of the unfinished business. We have no new business this evening, I see. Council reports, I'm very quickly going to go down the line. If you have reports for us, please try to keep it brief. We have quite a bit ahead of us this evening. So I'll start with Council Member Vance.
Don't really have a report after last week.
Okay. Council Member
Is that brief enough?
No report.
Deputy Mayor James.
I'm going to let Council Member Jaron cover it. Are you going to talk about the ETP letter that we got?
No, I was going to let you cover it.
When do we have to make this? Isn't until next meeting?
Right.
Yeah, we have one. I'm going to distribute this before I read it to everybody. I think that's a better use of time.
Let's do that.
There's a letter that we need buy-in from the council. So
the other thing
to the legislature.
The other thing we may want to distribute to the council is the handouts from the ETP meeting, particularly dealing with the 4 or 5 quarter construction. If nothing else, they're interesting reading.
If you have an unmarked copy.
I have an unmarked copy of the foldout, not the...
Because mine are notoriously handwritten.
Maybe we can get a clean copy of it. Okay.
So we'll save that for next time.
Okay. Anything else, Jim?
Nothing to report.
Okay. Councilmember Jarrett.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Today I went down to Tacoma to testify before the Washington State Transportation Commission. The city of Sammamish had put in a request that the name for one of the new 144-car ferries that are being built be called the Sammamish. And I very passionately made our position clear and pointed out that we had buy-in from the other three cities on Lake Sammamish. And I also pointed out that not only do we have a city named Sammamish and a lake named Sammamish, but there's the Sammamish River, which goes through some more cities. And then there's the Sammamish Trail, which connects to the Burke-Gilman Trail, which goes through Lake Forest Park in Seattle, all the way to Ballard. And if you go there, you can look out in Puget Sound and see the ferry.
In other words, you were long-winded.
And how long did all this take?
Pointed out that this impacts over 1 million people. Needless to say, we didn't get it.
You oversold it.
Yeah, referendum?
It turns out that the commission had a subcommittee, the ferry selection committee, which had already done all sorts of machinations, and they came with their preferred choices. And so the seven of us that came to defend our choices at the meeting, it was perfunctory at best. And now I have empathy for some of you in the audience coming to our meetings. So we will have a new ferry called Sammamish and not Sammamish. So maybe it's a contraction of our name.
Maybe you and I can go.
Can we do a midnight auto on this thing and rework the name?
It's small like in Whatcom County.
Yes.
Near Bellingham.
No, that's what it's about. So.
How many people do they have affected by this?
Yeah, 50?
Well, they had a couple thousand on a petition for the name, so that's a word to the wise. The next time, if they ever build another ferry, we might do a little more background work first.
Okay.
That's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Alderama.
Yes, since the last time we were able to have the council report, I had attended two meetings with the Eastside Fire and Rescue Board of Directors, but more importantly with their Service Delivery Task Force. And I wanted to report to the council that we have been looking at a number of issues, including the station locations, their response areas that they're responding to, as well as staffing levels are being discussed. So I just wanted to make everybody aware of that issue out there. And it's been moving quite positively, and Council Member Jarrett has been accompanying me to those meetings. Additionally, I also wanted to report that recently I had attended the Citizens for Sammamish meeting. They had a session out there, and one of the concerns that was coming up was trying to look at whether it is a review of the permit process was probably the positive recommendation that came out of that. I had mentioned that that is already being scheduled, and they will probably be inviting either the mayor or the city manager to their meetings. The Citizens for Sammamish does not meet again until after New Year's, January 7th.
Okay, thank you. From the mayor's standpoint, a couple of things. First of all, a gratis PR announcement. The SAMI Award nomination process is open now. It will stay open through the 1st of December. If you have people, anyone, residents of Sammamish, someone who may not live here but works here, or someone who may not live here but volunteers here, they are eligible for the award. So please, I encourage you to go online and do the nominations, because after December 1st, you won't be able to do it. I have about six that I plan to make myself.
Just a comment.
Okay.
They have always had in their mission, it's very important to distinguish between the city of Sammamish and the board that makes these awards. They're two independent group. And I know you're on the board, and it's easy to forget that distinction, but the city itself does not make those decisions. We do some financial funding for it, but I think you need to make very clear, and I think it's a great thing to do, that they are independent and that it's the people of the city that are making those decisions. So I think that's very...
You are absolutely correct, Councilmember Witten. It is not a city function. but it is of city interest, so that's why I mentioned it. Along with Councilmember Vance, I've been attending some of the funding model discussions for Eastside Fire and Rescue, and like Councilmember Valderrama, I am pleased to report that we're seeing some progress there, and I remain cautiously optimistic that we'll come to a favorable conclusion to this whole process for the city. Other than that, I have no further information for the city. I know the city manager report has some content to it this evening, so I'll turn it over to Ben.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Next week, we'll give an update on the fire study for full council, so that's scheduled on our calendar, so we'll bring everybody up to speed with more details. And I appreciate that you're trying to be respectful for the time to get the meeting moving tonight. I have one item, and that has to do with the council office hours. We picked the Wednesday evening to be the council office hours. At the time when we picked, we didn't have that many conflicts with some of the regional meetings. And we're finding it out that we do have some conflicts with those council office hours and then the regional meetings. It's a Wednesday evening. It's once a month. Not that we need to address it tonight, but frankly, we find ourselves a couple of times in the past to cancel it because everybody was busy attending different meetings and different activities. You might want to consider doing this maybe every other month or pick a different day of week. That might work better for you guys.
Or a different week in the month.
Or a different week in the month. So we don't need to, again, address that tonight. I just want you to know that that's something that we need to address it because it doesn't look good on all of us that we put the meeting and then we cancel it last minute.
I agree, Ben. I think our record on making this happen has been less than stellar due to simple lack of people being available for the thing. We originally thought it'd be a good idea to align it with the farmer's market. Of course, farmer's market's older now.
Right.
From the standpoint of getting more foot traffic in the door to it, I'm not sure we achieved that objective. And I consider this last summer a bit of an experiment that may have flopped, frankly. Moving it to line up with the council meeting has other problems, too, from the standpoint that
leadership
we
meetings.
Tend to get leadership meetings or committee meetings on these same nights as well. So I think it might be best to just sit back and take a look at this and perhaps come aim at the first of the year for a cutover of some sort.
Yep.
I'm not sure how many people are really going to want to talk to us over the
Christmas
Thanksgiving time. And Christmas period anyway.
Probably not that many. So we're going to cancel the December meeting and then to pick a new date in the beginning of January.
Or at the retreat.
Well, should we do it, pick a date of the retreat?
Or? Sure, we can do that too. But then we need to decide what we want to do in January meeting, but let's not decide on
Let's not decide that tonight. Let's try to look at everyone's calendar and figure out one that might work.
Right.
I'm thinking maybe the third week of the month as opposed to the first or second
sure.
week.
With that, City Manager's report is concluded, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you. There's no executive session this evening, am I correct? Okay, then I'm going to move for adjournment of our, we're calling it a special meeting this evening, so that we can then reconvene into our study session.
So let's,
when we do that, we'll take a 5-minute break in between and then resume. So may I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, say nay. We are adjourned. And we will reconvene at on that clock at 7:30.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to reconvene this meeting and open the study session. We have two subjects of discussion this evening. One is the Southeast A Street Preferred Master Plan, and number two is the Community Garden. And believe we have Jesse on the stand for the duration. Is that not true, Mr. City Manager?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. Our Parks Director, Jesse Richardson, is going to give us a staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. I'm also joined this evening by, well, there she is, Pauline Cantor, the chair of our Parks Commission. And the Parks Commission does have a recommendation on this plan, so I'll invite Pauline up after we get through this presentation. It is now my pleasure to present to you the preferred alternative for the Southeast 8th Street Park Master Plan. I don't even remember when we started this. It was a long time ago, but it's always nice to get to this place finally. We did have a public meeting not too long ago, and we reviewed this plan with the members of the public and also the Parks Commission. So tonight, we're asking for your direction and general consensus so that we can begin the SEPA process and hopefully adopt the plan sometime after the first of the year. A couple of things that we considered as we, these are broad overview items that we considered as we were working on this plan. Both parcels, Site A and Site B, are in close proximity to our neighbors, so in our design process, we want to be considerate of that. They are encumbered pretty significantly with sensitive areas, some streams and wetlands, and something to be mindful of during planning. As you know, Ms. Piggott has maintained a pretty remarkable trail system on both sites, and for the most part, we're keeping those trails. It's nice to inherit property that's already like a park. We have a whole slew of buildings between Site A and Site B, and I'll talk about our proposals for those in just a few minutes. And then parking and access were probably the two biggest issues we faced in working on this plan. Design goals, obviously a park that is welcoming to our community. We really wanted to enhance, protect, and celebrate our natural systems, keeping this more like a preserve than a park. And obviously providing outdoor opportunities. A couple strong themes came out of our public process, environmental education and heritage. So we've tried to honor those as we walked through the process with the public. So what I'm gonna do now is kind of step you through the preferred plan. We'll start with Site A, which is the site that we currently own, and then we'll work our way to Site B. We've provided some images to the right, which in some cases they're close but not quite exact, just to give you an idea of what we're talking about. So parking on Site A, the major primary parking is proposed on the street on Southeast 8th. We can accommodate about 40 parking spots in that location. That's right inside that red box. We're also proposing formalizing the park entrance, and you can see that upper that picture in the upper right-hand corner. Gives you an idea of what that might look like, although for this park it would look much different. The parking would be paved asphalt. One thing I will mention about the parking is that the Parks Department doesn't get in the business of designing parking, so we would be working closely with our Public Works Department to design those spaces. In terms of access, if a road is to be built, we are proposing a two-way paved road into the house and looping back out. You may recall some previous ideas where we had proposed a loop road, and after studying the site a little bit more, we discovered that was going to be cost prohibitive because we have to essentially cross a wet area and we have to build a bridge. We were also asked to look at a one-way road with pullouts, and what we determined is because you have to make that turn, it doesn't stay, we can't have a one-way road going around that turn rule easily.
You mean a one-lane road?
One-lane road, not one-way.
Yeah, one-way makes it harder.
The other problem with a one-lane road with pullouts is eventually the pullouts become a maintenance problem, and you end up with two lanes in the end. So we talked with our maintenance staff, and we really felt that if a road is ever constructed, it should probably be a two-lane, two-way road.
Like 20-foot width, two 10-foot lanes.
Exactly. So the one thing I do want to mention, though, about this road is, if you're familiar with Pine Lake Park, we have a road that runs right through the middle of the park to launch boats. From a park management perspective, it's like my worst nightmare, and there's nothing we can do about it. So unless this house is used, I do not recommend constructing vehicular access into this park. It's when you're dealing with cars and park users, there's always a potential for conflict. So just wanted to plant a seed on that one. That being said, if at some point the house is activated for use, Then we've proposed a smaller parking lot that's internal to the site. There's about 10 spaces in this area, with a couple of ADA spots as well. And we also have room in front of the garage for some ADA spots if we need to use them. 10 parking spaces is comparable to the parking lot at Beaver Lake Preserve and Evans Creek Preserve, to give you an idea of size. It's generally the minimum we build because we know it 10 meets a lot of needs. This area is, if you've been out to the park, it's kind of that open area that we had originally discussed to be used for parking. The intent right now is to keep it green and use a reinforced turf product like the new generation of grasscrete, but to only use this when we need to overflow. So,
is that considered pervious surface?
From a planning perspective, yes.
Okay.
We've struggled with this in, as you know, in some of our parks, but we believe the new generation products would meet our needs here. So what we're trying to accomplish here is that we don't feel like we need a big parking lot, except on days when we have something major going on at the park, like a big volunteer work party, which we've had several. So in that case, we want to have enough space at the site to accommodate all the cars so we're not overflowing into the neighborhood. I don't know how many cars we could accommodate here. I'm guessing another 30 maybe. So in total, you've got almost 80 parking spots at full build out. To give you a comparison, I think the parking at Beaver Lake Park on the lodge side is about 100.
Mm-hmm. Before you leave that particular discussion,
sure.
Did I notice that you're planning to pave the access road?
Yes, we would be paving both roads on both sites if they're built.
Why?
The reason really is noise. One of the concerns the neighbors had was about noise, and while both could be constructed with gravel, we just think from a common courtesy point of view that it would be better, we'd be better friends to the neighbors and those houses adjacent if they can't hear the gravel.
Well, I can appreciate that, but if we have a minimal number of parking spots, like say we just have the 6 that you're showing there, the amount of traffic to me just doesn't justify it.
You would think, but if you think about how Pine Lake functions, the only people that are supposed to drive down that road are the people launching their boats. Mm-hmm. And we have an endless number of cars driving that road all the time. So there's no real way I can, if that road is opened up and we put parking internal to the park, there's no real way I can manage that. So you're probably gonna have people driving in and dropping off. And I would anticipate a higher number of trips. And unfortunately, even more back and forth because they're gonna be looking for parking. But here's the good news, is if we don't build the road, it stays like it is now, gravel. So we can come back to that, certainly.
We can always pave it later.
Yep, mm-hmm. Yep. You'll notice that in this case, this road, it runs really close to that property line. And so I do have some concerns about the neighbors nearby. As I mentioned in my intro, one of the strong themes that came out of the public process was that a desire to have a place where school groups, particularly our local schools, could come and learn about environmental education and on-site bee heritage education. And so some of the people we talked to at the school said we really need a place to gather when we bring kids. So we've proposed what we call an education circle, which the pictures here are probably a little bit bigger than what we'd build. We really only need to accommodate classroom size, so about 30 people total. But it would be covered, so when people come to visit the site, they can get out of the weather and they have a home base. We're also talking about maybe dual purpose and making sure it can function as a picnic shelter as well. So that's that amenity. The key feature, the one thing that makes this park unique from all the other parks in our system is our proposed elevated boardwalk, which is unique in the sense that we would like to make it accessible. If you visited parks or done any traveling where there's elevated boardwalks, there are very few that are accessible. And so we think we have the right grade and elevation at this location to make this an accessible boardwalk. It's kind of the one remaining feature. As you know, we scaled down from earlier master plans, but this was really popular during the public process and I think supported by the Parks Commission as well, just because it's a unique feature. As a reminder, you know, this is a master plan, so this doesn't have to be built in phase one. And we also think this feature could be a good partnership project and potentially also eligible for grants if we decide to pursue it. Working further towards Site B, we have just an informal picnic area. This is already a grass area. We're not planning to irrigate the park beyond the house. So this would brown up a little bit in the summer. But it's existing right now. We would mow it regularly. We'd probably put a couple of picnic tables there, and it would be a nice picnic area kind of tucked back in the park. There are a couple spots, again, on the theme of education, where we've got wetlands and some really neat habitat, especially during this time of year when it doesn't stop raining. For functionality, we need to elevate those trails and build boardwalks. And those are things that we've done a number of them down at Evans Creek Preserve, so you know what they look like. But there's also an opportunity to expand those a little bit and create like some observation areas so that there's an image of what that might look like above. The nice thing about a lot of the features you see in both Site A and Site B is that we can build these in really small pieces. You may recall in our early days of park development, we developed big phases. They were million-dollar plus projects. This master plan was designed so that we can do one piece at a time and do it efficiently. So this is an example of what that might look like. The house. I'll be honest with you, I've come full circle on my recommendation on the house. When we first started this project, the community center, I don't even think was on the ballot yet. And we anticipated, because the house is in very good condition, that this could be used similarly to the lodge, so with some recreation purpose in mind. I've been calling it an activity center to keep it generic. But I'm going to tell you my recommendation has changed. And I'll walk you through some options, and then I'll come back to that. So the house, Sevda Braun, our architect, she came up with two different floor plans. Essentially, to activate the house for public use, we need to put in two accessible restrooms, which are shown to the left there, converting one existing restroom and then converting a closet to the other accessible restroom. And then we'd preserve the restroom that's shown on the right. From there, we'd have one multi-purpose room, which I believe that room is the master bedroom if you've been in that house. It's about 600 square feet. And we'd keep these two rooms split. There's a wall and a fireplace that divides those rooms. And also the floors are recessed. So for ADA accessibility, we've got to raise the floor. We actually don't have enough room to put in ramps. So this plan has us keeping the two multi-purpose rooms separate, keeping the two other bedrooms, we're calling them office storage for lack of a better term, and keeping the kitchen where it is. And just to do all of that, I'll just note the cost is about $180,000. That's just to do those renovations. Sevda drew up a more aggressive plan B to sort of eke out a bigger space. And in this case, we have the restrooms in the same location. We keep that multi-purpose room, which is the master bedroom. The benefit of this is that the house could be isolated, so if we were going to rent the facility, we could rent that room without having to rent the rest. And then this calls for us taking out that middle wall and moving the kitchen entirely, which gets us to about a 1,500, 1,600 square foot space. To give you an idea, this room is almost 2,000 square feet, so it's a much more functional space than those smaller rooms. The back bedroom stays as a back bedroom, and then the kitchen actually moves and becomes a catering kitchen. Now, the cost for this is closer to $270,000, so there's quite a significant difference. I'll tell you, from the public process, the general sense from folks was, you know, this version is a little bit too much right now. Let's wait and see. And that meeting happened even before the election, and I know we're waiting for that to be certified. So it's tough right now for me to make a strong recommendation to use this house right now for recreation purposes, knowing that we have the potential for a community center that will meet should meet most of our indoor recreational needs in the near future.
Jesse, two questions.
Sure.
On Plan B. First of all, the wall you're removing, I hope it's not load-bearing. Has that been checked?
I'm sorry.
I hope it's not a load-bearing wall.
Actually, it potentially is a load-bearing wall, but we would be...
Reinforced?
Yes, thank you.
And that's part of the cost, Chris. Okay. The second thing is, would Plan B be more usable from a renting point of view than Plan A, in your opinion, or not?
It is. This is a much better space to rent. I can envision weddings and such happening here. My concern, and I shared this at the public meetings, is that we have the Beaver Lake Lodge, which is a really highly desirable rental facility. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure that here in Sammamish we have the capacity to sustain two like facilities and keep our revenue streams high. Mm-hmm. So it's something that I would say we need to evaluate candidly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The other part of it is also, it's just not only the cost of the house renovation, that all the other auxiliary costs goes along with it. Part of it is the parking. So how do you provide the parking? So it's, and I think that what Jesse and I were talking about, that since the community center decision has been made by the community, we will have an opportunity to provide some of the indoor recreational the uses that we were thinking prior to the community center on this particular house.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Councilmember,
I guess we'd also have to build that road.
Yeah.
That we just decided to right. put off. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah. Again, I go back to my comment on the road. We can always do this.
Right.
So,
yeah, I think in my memo I indicated it. This may be a situation where it's just not now. We need to reevaluate. Mm-hmm. I am concerned though about leaving the house vacant.
So am I.
Yeah, and so I noted that we've had a preliminary conversation about a caretaker possibility here, mm-hmm. renting the house and entering into a caretaker's agreement, which is my recommendation at this point.
Nancy?
My question is this. I have the same concern about the Freed House and other things where we don't have a need that just pops out at us and where we're still up in the air about the use. And with Site B, because we don't own it, we can always, I mean, that's a future thing anyway. But with this house, it seems to be in good condition, and I'd hate to let it go the way of the Kelman House and through deferred maintenance fall apart. So I would like to see an approach to adopting a plan that has a lot of ifs, ands, and buts in it that says it's, the policy of this plan, it would be okay to do this, to build into the plan the ability to say at a future time without doing a major amendment to the plan that we've looked at this and we're holding this in reserve or do a shadow or whatever it is, but some approach that would permit us to have a plan that says, yes, we could go forward with this or yes, we may not, but build in a shadow overlay maybe for the house and for parking to go with the house. I mean, I don't think if you had evening functions like weddings and had people getting out at 11 o'clock at night, they're not going to want to go down an unlit road, even if it's paved out to the major road. They're going to want parking with a light that makes it safe and comfortable for a woman in heels and that kind of thing to walk out to a parking lot that's convenient. It could be your overflow parking. But I'd like to see something shadowed into the master plan.
I think that you're going to hear from Parks Director's recommendation not to do anything with this house right now, but except to get the caretaker. And because I don't want it to see this house staying empty there too. So we need to either get a real estate agent and lease it. And that lease may have some conditions attached to it in terms of the taking care of the fee out of things.
Or submit a remuse. Yeah.
And Councilmember Witten, you're right on track. All of these elements that you've seen will be in the master plan. Just my recommendation is that we don't build them right now. We evaluate in the future.
Exactly. And my problem with master plans before has been they've been overly aggressive without qualifying it, appearing that we at some point in time will be doing these, like the landings is a classic case. With a 400-foot beach stretch. But if we could put this in as an if.
Yep.
Okay, Councilmember Valderrama?
No, following along the lines that Councilmember Witten said, I think that that is something that would be very prudent for us, and particularly for this property and gift that we're looking at to be natural and passive. In that line, in vain, I'm still concerned about the rationalization for the parking. At full blowout, you have 51 parking spaces, including ADA for Site A, and you have another 10 on Site B. 61 plus you identified another 30 potential when Pine Lakes Park, as you had talked about, has a total of 60, and that's an active
82.
Use.
82.
Sorry?
80.
80. Okay, 80. So we're still going to that level of an active use park. So that, I'm trying to understand what is the rationalization for that many parking spaces?
That's again, keep in mind, this is a master plan. So that is, if the house is activated and this and Site A is fully built out, that's our proposed parking plan. And think about this house operating like Beaver Lake Lodge. So if that's happening, then we've shown what the parking needs to look like. If the house isn't activated, we can take a much smaller bite. And that's actually what we'll be recommending when I get to that.
You still have 40 stalls in phase one here shown to begin. And I'd like to go to a smaller increment as Councilmember Witten has, and then we can increase.
Sure. Maybe I'm going to get to the phase one recommendation in a minute, and we can talk a little bit about the parking if that's fair.
Fair enough.
Okay. So what I wanted to close with on Site A is there is a barn. It's actually in good condition. We're using it as our maintenance. It's housing all of our maintenance equipment at this site. In terms of outdoor restrooms, the restrooms that are dedicated for use at this park, we're actually proposing to put them into the barn, similar to, you know, when you go to the Beaver Lake Lodge and you have that outdoor access for restrooms. It's the same concept. We haven't quite figured out what type of restrooms we're going to be putting in here. We're evaluating the septic system on the site now. If there's a potential to connect, we would. Otherwise, we would probably consider a waterless restroom option like we've done at Evans Creek Preserve, which has been very successful and no odor. Or as even a smaller step, which isn't my personal favorite, but we can always just keep the honey buckets at the site as well. So that piece... That piece requires a little more information. Quick comment on the trails. The dotted red lines here are the existing trails on Site A. And the master plan actually calls for, on this site, eliminating just a couple sections. So the purple is the proposed trail system. Wherever possible, we're trying to pull the trails off the property line. In some cases, we weren't able to do this because of the location of a wetland. But we have some other options, including, you know, enhancing the vegetative buffer between us and the neighbors. And this is a good segue now, moving into Site B, which is really crisscrossed with existing trails. So you can see on Site B, the existing trails are in red, and our new trail plan is in purple. So we're proposing to abandon all of those trails that are on the property line. And in the case of Site B, for those of you that have walked the site, those trails, there's nothing between the trail and the fence, so you have direct access into the neighbor's yards. And we didn't feel good about that, and I don't think they did either. So this is a nice compromise. The other thing is that even though this trail system is really beautiful, it's designed for pretty low use. And once we get public out on this site, all those crisscrossing trails will result in some pretty severe vegetative damage. So we needed to simplify the system a little bit so that we could preserve the site. Okay, parking on Southeast 8th. At the north end of Site B, we have actually it's outside the property limits, we have a storm water pond and some right-of-way. So it's part of the public process. Some of the neighbors said, hey, let's share the burden and access to this site. Let's get some up north and we'll have some down south too. So we worked with Public Works. We know that we have room for potentially three parking spots, parallel parking. The last public meeting, people said, who would use these? The person that would use these is probably the person that lives in Lancaster Ridge or somewhere in that area that has little kids and can't make the walk to the site and wants to get there with their strollers. So probably fairly low use, you know, just a couple cars, probably less than a dozen per day, I would predict. There's no way to get parking into the park at that site unless we wanted to spend a lot of money because of the grade, and it's also significantly treed. So we propose parking on the outside. We have a couple cool little features, which we'll just add to the environmental theme at this park. This is a bird blind, which bird blinds look differently everywhere you go, but it's essentially a structure that you can stand behind and the birds can't see you, and you can look and see what they're up to. So the picture is what one might look like. Again, they can actually be much simpler than that. Throughout this park, we're going to obviously be abandoning some trails, and there's lots of opportunities just in general for habitat restoration and enhancement, and I don't need to go into that in too much more detail. This is one of our favorite photos. There are some areas of the park where the trails are wet, and there are some areas of the park where Ms. Piggott has installed boardwalk. Unfortunately, the boardwalk that's there needs to be taken out and replaced with something that meets our public standards. So we'd be replacing some sections of boardwalk, and I just wanted to note that there. All this trail work can be done through a partnership with WTA and our own in-house trail stewards, so it's not going to be too cumbersome.
And WTA is?
I'm getting bad about that. Washington Trails Association. My apologies.
Thank you.
She's hot on Cameron's trail.
I don't think I ever use as many acronyms as Cameron does. Okay. There's a beautiful meadow out on Site B. I think most of you have probably seen that, and our intention is to keep it a meadow. The way we manage our meadows in our park system is they usually get mowed down 2 or 3 times per year only. Otherwise, they remain wild. What I want to do now is talk about the structures, and Council Member Witten asked about this earlier.
Before you go there, you're rebuilding most of the trails in Site B from the map you showed earlier.
Actually, I would say that we're abandoning a lot of them, so that's covering over and revegetating.
And you're going to be pushing new trails through what is now a forested area, probably. I'm assuming you're going to recover the plants from this area to try to reestablish the vegetation in the existing trails?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. We're trying not to cut trails where it doesn't make sense to, and actually we're not cutting that many new trails. It's mostly pulling those that are off the property line, revegetating those areas. But yes, we do try to reuse plants when we can.
Okay. Thank you, Jesse.
You are welcome. Okay, so let's talk about the structures. This site is a little more challenging. All the buildings are clustered in that portion of the site shown in the red box. First things first, as you know, and we have some of our neighbors that were part of this process here tonight, parking and access was probably the most controversial issue, especially on Site B. What we ended up proposing is a loop road. We are proposing this to be paved. And this is because there is a house right next door, and we just felt that gravel was going to be really noisy and inconvenient for those folks. This meets our code for fire trucks and buses. One of the questions that's been asked several times is, where do the buses park? We didn't design bus parking, but what we've heard from the school districts is when they're running over from Discovery Elementary, they just drop off and they go and do something else and come back. So we didn't feel there was a strong need for that. Parking here for 10 cars. This is, I know we've had some requests to reduce the parking size. I really, as your parks director, feel that 10 is the minimum size for a parking lot. It's the minimum size we build for our preserves. It ensures that we have enough to meet all the needs for this park, even though it's a generally passive park. The parking surface is, again, reinforced turf or the new generation of grasscrete, so it will look green like it does in the image. Oops, right there. We are proposing a picnic shelter on this site. We did feel strongly, and I think the Parks Commission felt this as well, that there does have to be a usable structure. I've shown two images here. The one at the top is the big shelter at Pine Lake, and the one on the bottom is a small shelter at Sammamish Landing. So if you can envision sort of a happy medium between the two, that's the size we'd be looking at here. It would be... Whether it's going to be a rentable shelter, I don't believe it will, at least not right now. There's not enough parking and infrastructure to support that. But on a day like today, when it starts monsooning, it's nice to have a place to get out from the weather.
So how many tables or people would it accommodate if you had a school group, for example? What's the capacity of?
It's probably 3 or 4 picnic tables. The top one at Pine Lake only has 4 tables in it, but it has room actually for more. And that small structure at Sammamish Landing has 2 picnic tables. So we're looking at somewhere in between three or four tables.
Thank you.
For small kids, that could probably be, you know, 25 to 30, mm-hmm. easily.
The sauna building. So this building was originally a sauna, and it's used for, I think, storage right now. The same goes with Site A. We need a place to locate our park restrooms, and SEBDA studied all the buildings on Site B, and she recommends that the sauna actually be converted for the restrooms, and she's done some graphics here. So just one end of the building is needed for two restrooms. We don't believe the septic system on this site is in any condition to connect to, but I haven't confirmed that yet. So in that case, we would probably be looking at a waterless restroom option here as well. Once the restrooms are built, we have kind of an interesting, I think it's 400 square feet of space that we're not sure what to do with right now. So it would be just as it is.
Storage?
Yeah, it could be storage. Mm-hmm. The Tanner House is a problematic house. I can't recommend, and there wasn't really a strong public push to preserve this house. If it were used for any type of public purpose, it would require significant upgrades and renovation. The foundation is a cedar log foundation, just to begin with, so we have pretty major problems.
Is this the only structure with that issue?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. For right now, we don't own the site. I'm not comfortable saying this is a house we would take down, but the commitment level in this master plan is basically to preserve it, make sure it doesn't fall down, and perhaps to reevaluate our need in the future. The garage, this is another structure that, because we have such a big barn on Site A, we don't have a significant need for another maintenance area. So in the interim, I think we would possibly use this as a maintenance space and evaluate if it's something that we need for the future. If not, this might be a structure that we would recommend taking down as well. Again, I'm uncomfortable making those recommendations considering this is a property the city doesn't own yet. So for right now, they're still shown on the plan. And finally, the reared house. This is another one where public process was really pushing towards, you know, using it for displays and a museum, and I'm just loosely saying heritage education. So we haven't, our recommendation is not to use it as a rental facility. It's obviously a long ways from being usable, but we've just kind of loosely said heritage education. I again can see some weekend hours where people might visit, very low volume levels, and possibly school groups as well. Okay, what will it cost? These are numbers that we've been working on for a couple weeks. We didn't have them ready at the last public meeting. Okay, so if we built everything I just showed you, the total construction cost at Site A would be about $2.7 million, and Site B would be $1.4 million. So the total of 36 acres is a little over four. One thing I just wanted to share, because anytime we see these numbers, it's a little bit scary.
I am.
Ebright Creek Park was a 12-acre park that we spent $3.7 million to develop at a cost of about $300,000 per acre. At this site, both Site A and Site B, with a total of 36 acres, total cost $4 million at a cost of $113,000 per acre. So this is a much lesser development. We've also done some estimating on the maintenance costs. What I'll note about Site A is that full build out, if we built everything you saw, it would add $112,000 to our parks budget. We're already counting some maintenance costs for the existing site because it's open as a park now. And Site B, $273,000 roughly. These are very preliminary estimates, so please take them with a grain of salt. Neither one of them includes house operations. A breakdown, and I don't wanna really go into too much detail here, but you know, you can see that the boardwalks and trails on Site A altogether is the biggest chunk. Parking and access is very significant, and the structures and utilities is also a pretty high number. Contingencies, we've been fairly generous with our contingencies just because this is a planning level estimate. And this is Site B. Some of the numbers look fairly similar. But again, we've got you know, the structures and the houses definitely contributing the highest cost of the projects. Here's what I'll tell you. As I mentioned earlier, the beauty of this master plan, and we did this intentionally, is we took a lot of small pieces and put them together so we can build in very small increments, or we can do larger phases, which leads me to our recommendation on phase one. We are proposing in phase one on site A that we build the on-street parking. We've discussed internally and with Ben about whether we only build half or we build the whole thing. There's a significant savings to just building it all at once. Otherwise, you're looking at two mobilization costs. So for right now, we're recommending doing the whole thing. We're also recommending formalizing the park entrance, as I discussed. We're looking at removing the trail along the fence line and developing a new cross-meadow trail system. And keep in mind, this trail work is stuff that we can do with volunteers and potentially in-house staff as well. We will provide ADA access. Our desire is actually to bring in ADA access from that central entrance point, but we haven't had the time yet to figure out how that trail would lay out. So for right now, we know we can bring in ADA access off the main road.
Go ahead, please.
I'm concerned about the conflict between pedestrian and vehicular use on the roadway into the park. When I see at Pine Lake Park after the concerts and other activities, even just in the summer with the mm-hmm. intensity of use, cars coming and going, there is now a little bit of a sidewalk there, but it's still people are in the road and the cars, it's a conflict with potential for whatever. Is there some way we can build some kind of a pedestrian path parallel to the roadway?
That's actually what's proposed. It's not shown here, but it would be adjacent to the road. And with this phase one, we are not proposing activating that house. So the only vehicles going in and out of the park would be park maintenance vehicles.
Jesse, isn't that what's shown to the left of the access road there?
There's
a line there of some sort.
Yes. There will be a trail adjacent. Ideally, we want to bring in the trail in at another location. But as I mentioned, we need to do some additional design work to make sure we can do that. Mm-hmm. Okay, one more quick comment. So phase one, based on the proposal I just shared, we anticipate the design and construction will be approximately $435,000. I'll just mention that this is a planning level estimate. We haven't gotten into the details yet. And we anticipate, and I think this number is a little bit high, the additional impact to our budget for maintenance would be about $35,000. I think it's probably closer to 20 or 25. But I haven't had time to go over the estimates real closely yet. Our budget is just a little, it's almost $450,000 for phase one in 2013. So that is the master plan. As I mentioned, Pauline is here just with a couple quick comments from the Parks Commission, if you'd like to hear from her, and then maybe we'll take questions. Is that okay?
Sure.
All right, Pauline.
Thanks, Jesse. Hi, I'm Pauline Cantor, Parks and Recreation Commission Chair. On behalf of the Parks and Recreation Commission, we unanimously endorse the final preferred design presented to us at our regularly scheduled meeting on Wednesday, October 3, 2012. It is the result of several public meetings with input from local residents and park neighbors, and looking over a range of ideas and proposals for the park, including proposals from several classes at two elementary schools. We carefully examined the impacts of park development on the neighboring properties and reached what we felt a compromise that was sensitive to the adjacent homeowners while also recognizing the needs and interests of the community. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to provide you the recommendations for the Southeast A Street Master Plan.
So I guess I'll just add one final comment. You know, tonight's purpose is to hopefully reach some consensus, get direction from you, and then we begin our CEPA process. We come back after the first of the year with this plan and also the full written document that goes with this plan for your approval.
Okay, Councilmember Jaren.
In phase one, that includes the custodial rental of the house? Fixing it up for custodial rental, or do you not first?
Actually, the house as is rentable. Are you talking about for the caretaker rental I was talking about? As it is today, there's very little that needs to be done. We had a repair last year on the furnace, but yeah.
And you have you anticipated the revenue from that as part of your?
Actually, we have not.
And Councilmember Valderrama.
Jesse, I just want to make sure I understood correctly. I know that you've not made a final decision on the Tanner House at this point in time, but it seems that you're inclined to preserving it but not making it accessible. Is that correct?
For right now, because we don't own the house, I am recommending that we include in this plan our intention to preserve it with the option to tear it down in the future if we determine that that's the best course of action.
Since they were originally looking at this as being a heritage educational facility and Mary Pigott had been looking at the same era homes, are you then implying the same inclination for the Freed Reed House that you're getting in that direction of just preserving it?
Actually, the structural, the Reed House has, it's in better shape, believe it or not, than the Tanner House. And it's on its way to being preserved and restored. So my recommendation would be to retain it. And certainly if our desire is to have sort of a heritage feel, then it would make sense to preserve the Tanner House just as it is. I just want to be very candid with you about that, the condition of the house. So it's we can keep it and just keep it as a shell and keep it sealed up.
Councilmember Whitten.
Price tag for the for elevating the boardwalk, and how long would it be?
I'm looking to my staff. I don't have that number at my.
It's buried in the other, so I couldn't figure it out.
The cost for that elevated, it's about 15 feet in the air. Boardwalk is about $500,000.
How much would it be if it weren't elevated?
That is elevated.
I said if it weren't.
A little bit less. What's the lineal? 300 feet.
So, but what would the cost be if it were?
Roughly half. I'm doing an engineering for you guys here, so I mean my step is pretty rusty, guys, so if I'm wrong, so just step say that.
So that's one question.
That slide rule.
Have we considered zip lines?
While we're talking, let's stay on that topic. So zip line.
Oh boy. pea patch. I know that was one of the possibilities in the alternatives discussed. Mm-hmm. You know, I personally don't think one pea patch in the commons, assuming that's where we go, should exclude a peach patch. In other areas, and well, I wouldn't want to put that kind of a use in site B if it's because of the parking and the other traffic issues. I'd like to see that retained as a possibility for the for this park, and I don't know how we could approach that. I don't want to make it a definite part of the plan, but preserve the potential for it so it would be very easy to do an overlay or something. Is there a process where we could do that for a pea patch if we came to a general common policy on it?
Your recollection is correct. The original scenarios we presented had several different options for a community garden. Public process was pretty strongly opposed to that, partly because it brings a much higher level of activity to this park, and it may actually necessitate more parking than what we've shown here. So it's been taken out of the plan. If the council would like it to remain an option for the future, then we probably need to put it back in and show a second phase of parking as an option, and that would preserve the option for you to make a decision about that in the future.
How much parking does a pea patch take?
You know, I could say we might just need to expand this parking lot by 50%, so another 5 or 6 spots, just to make sure. And ultimately, it depends on the size of the community garden as well.
I guess one of the things I wish we had included in our master park pro plan was a discussion of community gardens and how throughout the city, I would think it would be a wonderful visioning to include an element for that, but not force them everywhere.
Well, that could be around next on pro plan, so.
Yeah.
Jesse, if the Tanner House and that other garage that you mentioned were to go away, could that be the location for the pea patch? Repurpose that
the
area?
Top of my head, probably yes.
Okay. Could you go back to your cost roll-up for a minute?
This one or the?
The one that showed the maintenance as well.
That would be, this is the overview, this is.
No, okay, no, that one, yeah, okay, I'm sorry. Site A costs roughly twice as much as Site B, yet the maintenance cost is almost 2.5 times as high. Is that driven by what?
Well, keep in mind, that's why I have that asterisk there. I'm not showing the maintenance costs we're already incurring at this site. Those have already been built into the budget.
So this is incremental?
This is just the incremental costs for the improvements.
Okay.
So really, it technically, I think with all the build out, Site A maintenance costs would actually be higher than Site B.
Okay. Any idea what it might be?
I'm totally going off the top of my head right now. Our maintenance costs are probably a couple $100,000 if you factor in all of our labor.
I'm not surprised in view of the fact that Mary has two FTEs there on her property right now, so at least she did.
And I might be overshooting a little bit that number, but.
Okay. All right. I have no further questions. Deputy Mayor James?
I'd just like to go on the record as saying that I guess I was the guy after I listened to the steering committee about the pea patch not wanting to be under the high tension wires with herbicides and whatever else might have been sprayed over the years on that spot to keep anything from growing, that it was a good idea to move it. And I thought there was some consensus among the citizens to have it at this property name to be determined. And given the fact that the citizens through public input have decided that maybe that's not the best use and the next thing on our agenda is what looks like a great pea patch in the commons, I'm going to retract my trying to go against the public will and say that it seems like we found a home for the pea patch and the citizens will create demand for another one if that one is successful. And that location will be determined. But you know, I hate going through this public process, and I've been part of that, where the council comes up with something that wasn't even on the radar of the citizens.
Mm-hmm. The who else? Romero?
Well, I was just going to go back again to the comment we had spoken about the parking earlier on, and I'm still concerned about the full blowout and the number of these parking places for a passive natural park exceeding Pine Lakes. And so I'd like to see if we can phase in, and I know you mentioned of the 40, it may be more expensive to do it twice, but it may make a lot more sense that we may, as well as we've seen pictures of the burdens on that road during the winter times. So I put that in the ears of the council that it behooves us to be looking at, can we phase it in at a smaller cost? Also on Site B, I noticed that 10% of the cost of Site B that you had broken out were on the parking. So just to keep that in mind as well.
May I add to a couple things? If they were a specialized parking and you do it in two phases, I think you could be okay. In this case, you're right next to the road and the parking is all adjacent to it. You're gonna have one trade is relocating the fencing and another trade doing the sub-base work. And it would be a lot easier to do the 40 parking and cheaper one time than to go on out there doing the 25 right now and come back and do 15 later. It's just a very cost-effective way of doing it. So we won't be saving too much money at the end if you were to say that let's just build 25 right now and then come back and 15 build in a couple of years later. I think we'd be serving the taxpayers better than if we just take care of that all that 40 at the same location. It'd be a lot more cost effective for us to do that.
Okay.
And this is the one that we're talking about at the road, right? Is that where you're focusing on, Romero?
The first 40.
Yeah.
Can you send us the numbers? Can you send us the numbers so we can look at them more carefully?
Sure, I'd be happy to do that.
And maybe a better breakdown if you have it conveniently available. Not if you don't, but if you have it available for how you came up with the summaries on, like, for trails and stuff. Thank you.
Don?
I just wanted to comment on the parking along Southeast 8th there. As you notice on this diagram, the parking does not extend all the way to the east, and it's very eastern corner is where the flooding is in the wintertime. And actually, in the wintertime, you're not going to have 40 cars there anyway.
Right.
So that's one point. So I would support doing the full parking at one time in the beginning. I also like the idea of the parking on Phase B at the upper part of it coming through Lancaster Ridge. I drove there a week or so ago, and it was obvious that that's a natural right at the end of that cul-de-sac.
Deputy Mayor James? Followed by Mr. Hitz.
When we first started looking at this, I think, Jesse, you said it better than anybody could have. We didn't even know the community center was a possibility, and now it looks like a likelihood. Obviously, we still have to get the operating agreement from the Y and tie up a couple loose ends, but this assumption is that we wouldn't, if we didn't have the community center, we would need some extra resources for the city, like an activity center. Some people have been calling it a senior center. And the whole goal was, how do we get parking? How do we get access to a house? How do we use the house? I would be shocked if we don't activate the house that we would ever fill up 45 spaces or whatever I counted on the street. And if I had to guess, we probably have about 10 to 15 spaces available just on parallel parking today. Is that correct?
You're probably about right. Mm-hmm.
So the question is that if we take a more minimalistic approach and maybe put, since all our eggs are pretty much going into one basket with the community center, you know, I know we allocated $400,000 possibly to do what you're saying. Is there even a more limited needs-based use for this park?
At least on a temporary basis.
Yeah, than what we had foreseen.
I'm sure there's a medium halfway point here. The only thing I will note is that we want to definitely formalize the parking. Right now, we've sort of got people parking in between trees on the grass, and it's, you know, we need to do something to make it look more like a parking lot. But I would be happy to explore the options.
The other thing we need to be careful, I absolutely right, we got the message, it has to be minimal. The worst thing we can do is that you put too few parking spots there, consequently you're spilling the parking in the neighborhoods. That's not also a desirable situation for us for looking at in the long term. If we were to have people to park, this is the place where we want them to park rather than going into the neighborhoods and cul-de-sacs and driveways and all that stuff there.
Having been on the receiving end of a few emails and a couple of phone calls about Duthie Hill Park,
yep.
I concur with that. The thought I had, the thought I, I'm, let me finish my thought here. The thought I had, though, was the parking off Lancaster Way is really going to be serving Site B. So that could be pushed off until we actually get Site B. I'm sorry, Tom, go ahead.
Yeah, I like the idea of the parking where it is. I know that I've been in there many times using those trails and in Site A, but I could see a lot of people parking there and using Site B. Mm-hmm. So I think those sites, those parking spaces could fill up very quickly, and the nice thing about them is they're on the side of the road. We can deal with drainage. We can do a lot of things with that.
Right.
We don't, you know, the other parking places in the middle, I think we're talking about a really distant contingency, if ever, of developing that part of the park much. And we may end up converting some of that space, that meadow area there, to something else, just meadow, perhaps. Yeah. So I would be in favor of environmentally, it's nice to have these parking spaces where in that location as opposed to somewhere in the park. And I like the idea of using some of the parking, what did we call it here, the kind of spur of parking at the top, which would serve some, perhaps some people living in the area, and the minimal parking at the bottom of Site B. So I think that's probably all we're going to need.
Nancy?
We had a contentious matter with Lancaster Ridge at one point in time and entered into, I think, a settlement agreement, Ben, which prohibited us from planning on using street parking, I think, for the lower commons. Is that correct? Something like that? Does that?
It's been a while. I need to refresh my memory.
I would like to have somebody on staff look at that agreement to see if we would be.
It wouldn't affect this particular park.
Well, but it might affect B with the cul-de-sac.
Yeah, we'll take a look at
it. I mean, I'd like to have some information on that before we finalize the parking issue.
Good point.
I mean, I've already heard from some of the Lancaster Ridge homeowners that they're concerned about that.
Don?
One other point about these 40 stalls up there in Southeast 8th. We are planning to work on the connecting link between the lower commons and the northeast corner of Site A.
Yes.
And that would make this parking also parking for the trail going into the commons.
Right.
Yep. No. Good point.
Which might be forbidden under the agreement.
Well, we still have an agreement to make.
Let's get to the facts on it.
Mm-hmm. Just by comparison, we have 43 spots at the lower commons, so you can kind of get a visual of about how much parking that would be at this site.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. One final comment for me, and then we'll move on, and that is that whatever we're looking at doing in Site B, frankly, and I'm including the Lancaster spur, for lack of a better term, we may want to look ahead, and I know it's quite a ways off in the future yet, Jesse, and I don't want to presuppose anything, but frankly, we need to look at B and C. When we're looking at B, we kind of need to look over our shoulder at what might happen in C in terms of parking capability, which might change our minds about what we do with C.
I think by design, the vision is that B will always be a secondary access point. A is primary, and C will be mm-hmm. primary. Mm-hmm. So we've kind of been thinking about that, which is why the parking lot on B is only 10 spots.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
Are we done with this one? Okay.
Thank you, Jesse.
Thank you,
Jesse.
And good job to everybody involved.
Seriously, yeah. I think this is moved an awful long way from last time we looked at
it. I do need to acknowledge my staff. This is the first time we've done a master plan in-house, and Linda, Kevin, and Kelly have been working on this quite a bit, so they did a great job.
And based on comments, I think the public felt listened to, so thank you again.
Right.
And thank you to the public for working with us on this.
Next item, because of the time, I mean, this actually, the previous item went longer, and it was good that went longer, so we had some discussion. So I'm going to do this thing very quickly. This is the good news. you told us that you want to put a priority on the community garden. I want to thank the Linda and Kevin, actually, and Kevin is sitting back there as our temporary parks planner. He's been doing a phenomenal job. So it is at the lowest commons. It is the picture, what you see out there is a 3D rendering of this particular garden. We have the funds. We have the budget. There's no need to allocate the new funds on this thing. The only thing that we need to do is when we first proposed the community garden in Beaver Lake Park master plan had a community garden in it. Lower Sammamish Commons master plan does not have a community garden in it, so we need to do a public meeting to make sure that the folks are living around that location are comfortable with the changes that we're making. If you're okay with this, where it's located, our goal is to set that public meeting and start the construction and hopefully get this thing delivered by this summer, coming summer.
Perfect. I'm sorry, by when?
By coming summer, 2013 summer.
Next summer.
So it's moving at the light speed. I want to thank Jesse, Kevin, Linda. Those are the ones that have been working on this thing. One of the critical issues was the water, and the water district was very helpful to us to work through this process. We were ready to go. And not because of this project, but we also have the community center project potentially coming up. So I think I'm going to keep Kevin for another year here to do a few other things for us. So he was hoping to relinquish his responsibilities, sir, but keep dreaming, buddy.
So, Mr. City Manager, I see the cost estimate on this is $150,000.
Yeah, it's a lot less than the Beaver Lake Park, partly because the topography that we're working here is a lot easier, and also the utilities are very easily accessible.
Good. That's all great. Have we decided how we're going to allocate these 60 plots? Is there a first come, first served, or?
Everybody's first. The council members will be at the bottom of the list. City managers below the council members. No, we haven't, so I'll figure out. We'll come back to you with some sort of a recommendation on that one as to how to do it. The folks are involved in this thing that they can probably give us some ideas, and I know Melanie's anxiously waiting for this one, but you will be at the bottom of the list also. Sorry, Melanie. City employees, council members will be at the bottom.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Two things. Can they grow marijuana here?
And
are there security measures so for deer and for people?
Well, we're doing some fencing out there, so it'll be a secure location for the animals. In terms of the marijuana, no comments on that.
I think we may want to look at the height of that gate. Just look at the picture here, because a deer could go over that easily. But
that's an 8-foot fence there, Mr. Mayor.
I know it's the gate I'm talking about, which looks like a 6-foot.
It could be taller.
One final question from me, at least. Are we going to just let people use these pro bono, or do we plan to have any kind of a fee for these?
I haven't developed any policies on that one. You know, our goal was to get the design ready. Those are the things that we can work on parallel track. Those are good questions.
I just wondered if that was discussed in conjunction with the Beaver Lake exercise. We've walked away from.
You have any ideas, Jesse?
Yeah, I can two answers. We know the demand is going to be greater than the number of boxes, so we've discussed a lottery system. And the Community Garden Steering Committee has put together some policy recommendations. I do anticipate there will be a fee for use that's pretty consistent with how most community gardens operate. It's generally not significant, but there's a value to having that space.
Okay.
We'll get back to you with those before the opening of this thing, so we'll finalize those details.
Okay.
With that, you're okay with this? So we're proceeding with it, so no turning back.
I'm fine with this.
All right.
I'm waiting until you get the contract, and I'm going to vote.
No, we're not going to have a marijuana garden there, so.
Okay, so that brings us to the end of the study session. At this point, I'm going to suggest we have a motion for adjournment.
It's only 8:40. Good job.
Okay, been moved. I didn't hear a second yet, guys.
Second, third.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
All opposed, maintain silence.
Thank you.